Hello everybody and welcome to session 14 of our data visualization class. This is our penultimate session. We're at the end here. This is exciting. And today's session is actually especially short, in part because the whole R ecosystem for making really nice graphics has improved tremendously over the past year or so, to the point where the whole purpose of this session is starting to disappear. And so we actually, if we go to the slides, we're just going to cover one topic today about enhancing graphics, and we're going to talk briefly about what it looks like to make graphics in the real world for like a publication like the New York Times or Washington Post or Wall Street Journal, or for something like a think tank like the Urban Institute, or even the different centers that we have here at Georgia State, the different policy centers that we have. They issue their own reports and they'll often have kind of a style that they're supposed to follow. Or even if you're trying to make a graphic that looks really cool and you want to use the CRAP principles with contrast, repetition, alignment, proximity, you want to kind of make your graphic a lot nicer and add all sorts of annotations to it and change the colors and do fun things to it. And so that is typically something that is done before 5 months ago, 6 months ago. That was something that you had to do in a separate program. The typical publication workflow, and this is still the case with lots of publications, is that you create a plot using R and ggplot and you do all your regular data visualization stuff. It's powerful because you can create maps, you can do bar charts, you can do scatter plots that are sized by different things. Like that's easy to do. That's why R is so powerful with ggplot, is you can make really quick, fast graphics that are, they look good kind of at a basic level. But they don't always follow all of the principles of contrast, repetition, alignment, proximity. The legend might be in the wrong order and you don't want to fight with R for an hour in Google and figure out how to rearrange the order of the legend. Or one of your labels when you do geomtext repel is in the wrong place and you can't get it to move to the right place no matter what seed you choose. And so what you generally do at that case, or in at that stage of creating graphics, is you actually move it out of R. You export it as a vector-based image. If you remember from one of the very early sessions of this class, we talked about the difference between bitmaps and vectors. Vectors are mathematical formulas that just tell, they essentially define the shapes of different shapes on a plot. And so if you have a bar chart, you'll have a line and it'll just say like, here's the bar. And if you open that vector file in a vector editing program like Illustrator, you can actually adjust the bar. You could like reshape the entire bar. You could fill it with a different color. If you have a label that's in the wrong place and you can't get it into the right place, as soon as you put that into Illustrator, you can drag the label and move it wherever you want. You have total control over it. And so you export it as a vector and then you edit it in some sort of external program. Often organizations that have like a specific in-house style guide, like you have to use certain fonts, you have to use certain colors, you have to use certain alignments, like there's a certain style you have to follow. This is, at this stage, you would take your regular ggplot, use a very basic theme, maybe get rid of all the themes entirely or just have some very small grid lines, and then you would put that into Illustrator and then fancy it up and make it use all the right fonts and make it use all the right colors and everything. Or if you're trying to do interactive things, often if you're working with JavaScript libraries like D3 that will visualize things for you, it's sometimes helpful to import vectors from R. And so you can make like a world map. If you do one of those weird cartogram things with the hexagons that are shaped like different things, you can export that to just as like individual vector pieces, and then using magical JavaScript skills, you can make that interactive. So if you hover over different hexagons, it'll tell you what state it is and what the votes were and stuff like that. And so those were generally the two options. You either export the thing as a PDF and edit it in Illustrator, or export the graphic as an SVG file and then tear it apart with JavaScript and make it all interactive in a separate program. So that's the typical publication workflow. It's still the workflow in most large organizations. For instance, this plot here, this is from 538. This is what all 538 plots look like. They have the same style. They use the same sans serif fonts. They use the same monospaced fonts for the axis title or the axis text here, this 120, 110. That's a specific monospaced font that they have purchased the rights to use. They have a specific font they use for all of their sans serif fonts, and they own all of those font files. And so they have specific colors they're supposed to use. I don't know if they export everything from R specifically. They may have some other program that generates these lines here, but this is basically geomline showing the offensive efficiency over time. And so this is really just like geomline there. It could have been made in R, it could have been made with some other program that they use. But what they did is they exported it from whatever program they were using into something like Illustrator, and then made all of the fancy edits there to make it look nice. And then it matches the rest of the stuff that they have on their website. This graph right here, this is from the New York Times, that shows excess COVID-19 deaths that are underreported based on higher than average death rates. This is an interactive graph. If you hover over it, it will show you different counts. You can actually change, you can click on the title right here and it'll change the time period that you're looking at. So they may have made like the actual lines here in, or the actual bars here in R, or at this point they probably have some fancy algorithm that does all of the stats behind the scenes, because it's going to like reshape the columns. If this was a print thing, this could very easily appear in print, because it has these different annotations and things here. Those annotations, if this was a print thing, would have been added after, like in Illustrator. So they would have exported this from R or some other statistical package, and then they would open this in Illustrator and maybe add those lines if they hadn't added them in R, add this this annotation, draw the line. They would have done some extra annotations here. Getting something like this, this plus 15,000 weekly deaths, but not showing weekly deaths in other places, that's fairly tricky to do in R. And so you reserve kind of the trickiest things, all those niggling little details that we were talking about a few sessions ago, you reserve those things for places where you have control over moving things by hand. And then you can export it and add it to your publication or add it to the website or whatever, wherever you want to have the final location for your graph. Where this whole trend got started for kind of the general public is back in like 2011, Nathan Yao published a book called Flowing Data. It's a fantastic book. It's basically an introduction to how to do data visualization using R. But the whole premise of the book is that you make graphics in R and then export them as PDF and open them in Illustrator and make them fancy. And this is this example right here. You're going to do this for your exercise today, using Illustrator or Gravit Designer or Inkscape or some vector editing program. The example he has here, he exported this from R, but not the whole thing. The only thing that came from R was the histogram here, these columns showing the number of hot dogs and buns eaten over time. And so this was plotted in R, and the reason they did that is so you didn't have to hand draw each of the heights of these columns. Let R figure that out with statistics. The grid lines also came from R, so you don't have to like manually draw those lines in Illustrator. But that's all. Everything else here did not come from R. You export this plot with just the columns and the grid lines and the numbers, the axis text, and that's all you export. And then you open that super basic empty plot in Illustrator. And then in Illustrator, this is where you can add text annotations. You can make bolded words in the middle of the text. You can add these lines pointing at the different columns here. You can move the legend to wherever you want. You can add a title, add a subtitle, add a caption, multiple captions down at the bottom. And so that was in 2011, at the point where R was and where ggplot was, you couldn't do this kind of stuff in ggplot. If you wanted bold text, like right here where it has the names of the winners here, if you wanted just the names bolded, that was impossible. If you used like an annotate layer and said label equals all of that text, the whole text would be bold or italic or whatever format you want. You wouldn't be able to target just specific text to make just that bold or just that a specific color. If you wanted to include these little graphics here, there was a way. You can use annotate and you can actually add figure like images onto your plot using annotate, but making it so that it's exactly the same height as this text box here, that's really hard to do, or that was really hard to do in R. This was an Illustrator thing where you had control over the shape of this and control over kind of where everything is aligning here. Back in 2011, when this whole concept was invented, there was no subtitle argument in the labs function. There was no caption argument. You could only add a title, and you could only change access text. But in the years since 2011, when this concept first became popular, they've added the subtitle section, they've added the caption section, and in the past year or so, the ggtext package has become a thing, and now you can actually make bold text in the middle of regular text. You can make different colored text in the middle of regular text. You can move the legend around wherever you want programmatically. So if you remember this chart right here, showing the changes in CO2 emission rankings, this chart was entirely made 100% in R and ggplot. None of this was, we didn't do anything in Illustrator. These arrows and the text, that was all here in R. These extra text down here, this right here saying improved and worsened, prior to a few months ago, before ggtext was a thing, that was impossible. That's a very common thing. If you look at the New York Times here, they do that. They say U.S. deaths above or below normal. Instead of having a legend, they just use the text of the title to show the legend. It's a very normal thing to do, but you couldn't do it in R. So you would have to export this as a PDF, put it in Illustrator, and then make all your fancy highlights in the titles and move things around. But now you can do this entire plot here without touching Illustrator, which is fun because you don't have to learn a new program. You just have to spend a little bit more time in R making sure everything is perfect and lined up. But if you spend that extra time adding a few more annotate layers, then you don't have to touch Illustrator. And if this data ever changes, or if we want to show the change in rankings between 1995 and 2020, we just have to change the data that we're looking at, and the rest of the whole plot will update. If you're using Illustrator, that's not the case. You're going to have a new chart, a new PDF, you'll put that in Illustrator, and then you're going to have to rearrange all of the fancy things that you added to make the arrows point at the right places, move the labels if they're in the wrong place. So you don't have to worry about that anymore. The way of the future at this point, which is different from what I've done in the previous times I've taught this class, I've had a whole session explaining how to move everything around in Illustrator, and you'll still get practice with that because lots of organizations will still do that. But for like starting from a few months ago up until the future now, using patchwork, which lets you put different plots together in different arrangements, and using ggtext and using custom fonts and changing the fonts directly in R, and then you can have subtitles be a light version of the font, have your titles be a bold version of the font, you can do pretty much anything you need to do in Illustrator enhancement wise directly in R nowadays. You can pretty much replicate an entire in-house graphic style just using R. So if you want to make that 538 plot with the gray and with all of the fonts that they used, if you can find, you can't have their fonts because they own those, but you can find very, very similar fonts on Google Fonts and use those, use the same colors, and you can make all of the same annotations and everything and make it look basically identical to what they do without touching Illustrator. Same thing with the New York Times. If you can figure out what font they're using and the colors, you can make that same COVID-19 graph in R without ever touching Illustrator or Inkscape or any other vector editing program, which is like incredible to me now. It saves a ton of hand editing time. It does increase the time you're spending with R because then you're going to be fiddling with things. And sometimes you will need to move it into Illustrator. For instance, if you have this plot here, and you cannot get Mongolia to go in the right place no matter how many different seeds you choose, or you don't want to only select Mongolia and plot that and use like a nudge or something, then you can open it in Illustrator and you can move that Mongolia label wherever you want. But unless you're trying to do really, really tiny things like that, this gets you like 99% of the way there, ggtext and patchwork and custom fonts, which is amazing. Interactivity is not quite at the same level. So you, a couple sessions ago, you worked with ggplotly, where you feed a ggplot into the ggplotly function, and then it's suddenly interactive. A few of you in your exercises took the time to figure out how to change some design features of ggplotly, and it was really tedious. That is not as advanced as places like the New York Times. In part, it's because the New York Times has a whole graphics division with people who are like trained computer scientists with JavaScript, and they know how to make really fancy graphs, and they have control over all the source code. If they want to add a new feature, they can just talk to their graphic design JavaScript people, and it happens. So that kind of stuff, they'll still export things from R or just use their in-house things. But it's kind of getting there with Plotly. Like if you're making a dashboard, as we're seeing right now, like most of the COVID-19 dashboards that states are making, they're not hiring external graphic designers and contracting out for that. They're using like Shiny dashboards and Flex dashboards with Plotly, which is the same stuff that you've been playing with. That's kind of the industry standard. It's not the best if you want to use all the same fonts that 538 does. That's really hard to do with Plotly. But if you're fine making it kind of look relatively basic, you can get most of the way there with a well-designed interactive plot. Moral of the story for today's session is, in the past, it was very important to understand Illustrator and be able to edit everything in Illustrator and make everything perfect. That's still important if you want perfect control over every tiny design element. But if you use all of the different annotate layers and use ggtext to make specific things bold and italicized and add backgrounds to text boxes, and you can do superscripts. This was very difficult before ggtext. This type of stuff was impossible pre-ggtext. You can basically make publication-worthy graphics directly in R without ever touching vector editing software. So on that note, you're going to deal with some vector editing software just so you can see how it works. That's your exercise. And it should be fun. So good luck with that.